UNTV News and Rescue Command Center. This is Y News with Angelo Castro III, Gerry Alcantara, and Darlene Basingan.
Good evening. The government sets to file drug-related graft case against personalities in the new Bilibid prison who are included in President Rodrigo Duterte's drug matrix. Rosalie Cos will tell us why.
The Department of Justice has started consolidating the affidavits of the witnesses as well as the evidence against personalities linked to illegal drug operations inside the new Bilibid prison, as revealed recently by President Rodrigo Duterte through a drug matrix. According to presidential spokesperson Ernesto Abella, several witnesses have already appeared before the DOJ. As soon as the information and affidavits are verified, drug-related graft case would be filed against the involved personalities.
Several witnesses have surfaced to prove certain allegations versus against certain personalities, and they're in the process of taking the affidavits of these particular witnesses, and if and when they have been finally verified, the charges may have to deal with graft and drug-related graft once information is actually verified.
Meanwhile, Chief Presidential Legal Counsel Attorney Salvador Panelo belittled the comments of Senator Leila de Lima's camp that the drug matrix released by President Duterte is a mere trash and has wrong grammar.
She was saying that wrong grammar pa yung matrix niya. As if the wrong grammar will alter the fact that, according to intelligence reports, as shown by that matrix, she is involved as well as other people.
The Chief Presidential Legal Counsel also said the drug matrix shows who are involved and how they are involved. The drug matrix shows the alleged relationship of Senator De Lima to Ronnie Dayan, who was her bodyguard and driver, who allegedly received monthly payola from inmate drug lords through General Franklin Bucayo, former Bureau of Corrections chief. Others involved are former Pangasinan Mayor and incumbent 5th District Congressman Amado Espino, who is allegedly the richest politician in Northern Luzon and has amassed unexplained wealth. Also in the list are former Justice Undersecretary Toti Baraan and his brother Pangasinan Provincial Administrator Rafael Baraan, who allegedly cover all the illegal activities of Espino. Rosalie Cos, UNTV News and Rescue, Malacanang.
The Volunteers Against Crime and Corruption is set to file more complaints against politicians involved in the illegal drug trade. Monokson will tell us why.
The Volunteers Against Crime and Corruption is preparing to file more complaints against government officials involved in illegal drug trade. Earlier, the group filed criminal and administrative complaints against Quezon City Mayor Herbert Bautista and his brother, Councilor Hiro Bautista. VACC says the two officials violated Executive Order 292 on dishonesty, neglect of duty, and proliferation of illegal drugs. VACC Chairman Dante Jimenez explains that this will serve as warning to all public officials involved in illegal drugs.
And that it will be also a warning to all na mga local government officials. You are to be held liable on the on your respective jurisdiction, ang inyong pong mga constituents. Matatagal na po kayo sa pwesto. Bakit lumaki ang droga sa inyong mga lugar?
VACC believes that many high local officials are involved in illegal drugs. But the group admits that they cannot do the filing of complaint on all of this by themselves. They need the cooperation of everybody who supports the campaign of the president in fighting illegal drugs.
Sample lang po ito. Ang VACC is just setting an example, a model. Kasi marami po talaga na...
Hiro Bautista admitted in front of the media that he is an illegal drug user, but the councilor reiterated that his brother, Mayor Herbert, is not an illegal drug protector. Sister Harlene says they are in support of the campaign of the president in the fight against drugs. Mayor Herbert is currently in Oslo, Norway, to help in the peace talks. The Bautista camp says they will not give a comment unless they receive a copy of the said complaint. Mon Hokson, UNTV News and Rescue, Office of the Ombudsman.
The Department of Justice wants to look into the bank records of drug suspects as mentioned in the affidavits of witnesses. Meanwhile, senators are pushing for more relaxed provisions of the bank secrecy law. Joyce Balancho will tell us why.
The Department of Justice is now investigating the proliferation of drugs inside the New Bilibid prison. Aside from affidavits by witnesses, they are now also pushing to look into bank records of drug suspects.
One witness has already finished his statement. Mayroon pang mga bank accounts na pinagdeposto ng pera. But we'll go to the details after these affidavits have been submitted to me. Definitely there will be bank accounts to be disclosed.
To ease the investigation of law enforcement agencies against drug suspects, Senator Panfilo Lacson filed Senate Bill 1025, which seeks to amend the Dangerous Drugs Act. In his bill, he proposes to include giving authority to agencies in examining bank deposits, assets, and other bank records of drug suspects. He says the current bank secrecy law is limiting the powers of agencies in terms of confiscating and forfeiting money from illegal drug trade. Senator Miguel Zubiri seconded this move.
Dahil sa sobrang higpit nitong bank secrecy law, tayo ay naging stambayan ng lahat ng sindikato, lahat ng magnanakaw, lahat ng smuggler at illegal operators of different vices. Dahil hindi po sila nahuhuli.
Senator Lila De Lima, who heads the Senate investigation on cases of extrajudicial killings and summary execution, is also preparing the Proceeds of Crime Act to trace where money from illegal drugs trade goes to. Meanwhile, the Philippine National Police lauded the steps being taken by the Senate in aiding them in going after drug suspects. Joyce Balancho, UNTV News and Rescue, Senate of the Philippines.
Motorists are experiencing moderate traffic, particularly in Cubao to Shaw Boulevard area. Nel Maribohok is at EDSA PhilAm to tell us why, live. Yes, good evening, Nel.
Yes, Gerry, it's Friday, so expect all major intersections of EDSA to experience moderate to heavy traffic. Let's take a look at the traffic situation here in EDSA. Vehicles are slow moving in Quezon Avenue all the way to Timog intersection area. There are long delays in Kamuning area up to Tituazon and Ortigas Avenue. Also, moderate to heavy traffic in Reliance up to Guadalupe. Let us check out our live points. In EDSA Balintawak, going to Monumento, it's light to moderate traffic. But going to Monumento, motorists will experience light traffic. In Rojas Boulevard, Baclaran going to Manila, light to moderate traffic. Baclaran going to coastal area, heavy traffic in that area. In EDSA Bagong Barrio in Calaocan, going to Monumento, it's light to moderate traffic. From Balintawak to Muñoz, our motorists will experience moderate to heavy traffic up to North Avenue area. In EDSA Guadalupe, going to Shaw Boulevard, it's heavy traffic starting in Makati area up to SM Mega Mall. But from Orense, going to Ayala Avenue, moderate to heavy traffic. In Quezon Boulevard, Quiapo, going to Loton, heavy traffic situation in that area. Also going to España, it's heavy traffic. And that is our traffic update. You're in EDSA. Back to you, Gerry.
Thank you for that report, Nel Maribohok, live from EDSA PhilAm, Quezon City. The Highway Patrol Group conducts an inventory of Metro Manila's traffic enforcement resources. Leah Ilagan will tell us why.
The newly designated Chief Traffic Enforcer of the Interagency Council on Traffic, or IAC, Police Senior Superintendent Antonio Gargiola Jr., leads the inventory of traffic law enforcement resources of the Metro Manila Development Authority, Land Transportation Office, and Land Transportation Franchising and Regulatory Board. Gargiola says traffic enforcers from the said agencies will be deployed tomorrow to Metro Manila's three main areas, namely EDSA, Mabuhay Lanes, and the arterial roads of EDSA, to ease the current traffic crisis. According to him, 300 personnel and 150 motorcycles will be deployed, while the MMTA has 350 personnel and 80 motorcycles.
From north to south, vice versa, kinandak po yan ang survey manual, yung sumasakay talaga po during peak hours, not peak hours, ano. Then they average that the change that was felt was 7 minutes. Ang nabawas. So, fully sana progressive yan.
The HPG director adds that the agency expressed their full support to IAC for traffic decongestion.
We have already met the essence of success. Yan po sa pamamagitan ng magandang komunikasyon ng bawat ahensya.
We pledge and we commit to give our unconditional and full support to the IAC, providing our logistical as well as operational support.
Narito po rin kami, maliit lang na isa na ahensya, subalit buong pusong sumusuporta sa adikain ng ating pamahalaan na maibsan po ang trapiko sa ating mga kalsada.
Meanwhile, the HPG will deploy 400 personnel, while the MMDA will deploy 2,300 once Phase 2 starts, where mourning the traffic involves the entire Metro Manila. Gargiola explained that the combined deployment shall ensure the presence of every designated traffic sector of the LTO and the LTFRB in registration and franchise violations. Aside from ensuring the smooth flow of traffic in EDSA, Gargiola says they will also guide and control the motorists as the true guardians of the highway. Leia Ilagan, UNTV News and Rescue, Camp Crame.
House Speaker Pantaleon Alvarez orders the recall of protocol plates issued to former and incumbent members of the House of Representatives. Nel Maribuhok will tell us why.
The leadership of the lower house expresses support for the passage of a bill seeking total restrictions of using protocol plates for lawmakers. Based on the memorandum of the Secretary General, the recall was made because of reports that certain vehicles have been spotted in indecent places or figured in crime-related activities.
We're requesting them to surrender first so that we can also check how many will be returned. We still have to determine what will we do next time.
Siyempre, dahil 17th Congress na tayo ngayon, at marami ng mga congressman na pinalit na hindi na ngayon congressman. So, para lang to avoid confusion at saka baka may ibang gumamit mo na hindi naman entitled.
The lower house also submitted a letter to Land Transportation Office for them not to accept the low-numbered license plate of past lawmakers. According to Navota City Representative Toby Chanco, it is better to institutionalize the restriction of using protocol license plate for congressmen. Chanco is pushing House Bill 413 regarding this matter.
Talaga medyo may intimidation yan. Kaya ako, ang pinakamabuti dyan, totally wala na.
The lower house leader supports the passage of the said bill.
Ngayon, kung merong final si Congressman Toby Chanco na ipagbabawal na yung paggamit ng mga protocol plates, susuportahan ko yan.
The disposition of protocol plates is by the virtue of Executive Orders 400 and 400A, wherein government officials are entitled to use low-numbered plates from the President of the Philippines down to the regional trial court judges. Nel Maribuho, UNTV News and Rescue, House of Representatives.
Two PNP Highway Patrol Group officers claim self-defense on the death of motorist John De La Riarte in Makati City last July 29. Roderick Mendoza will tell us why.
PNP Highway Patrol Group policemen denied the allegation that they intentionally killed motorist John De La Rearte following his arrest after a traffic altercation. In their counter-affidavit, PO3 Jeremiah De Villa and PO2 John J. Manonong claimed the victim was accidentally killed and they only acted in self-defense. PO3 De Villa says De La Rearte was making a scene when they arrived and refused to be pacified while threatening the driver of the car. They arrested him to bring him to Camp Crame. While traveling on their patrol car, De La Rearte allegedly snatched PO2 Manonog's firearm and he was compelled to shoot the victim to protect his partner. He says the victim was still alive when they rushed him to PNP General Hospital. The cops also denied taking the victim's money worth 33,000 pesos.
Siyempre, pwede naman nila sabihin kung anong gusto nila sabihin para pabulaan at saka patunayan na may dahilan sila kung bakit nila kailangan patayin ang kapatid ko.
The policemen also questioned the authority of the public attorney's office to investigate and conduct autopsy. But PAU Chief Attorney Persida Acosta insists they are authorized to do so under anti-torture law. She adds that killing the victim is unnecessary, even assuming that he was cussing and making a scene.
Pero bakit kailangan patayin? At bakit dito kailangan barilin? Bakit dito? Pag binaril ka dito, dito, sa bahaging ito, hindi ka bubuhayin. Kaya execution style ang kanyang mga tama.
Meanwhile, the NBI submitted the results of their investigation and autopsy of the victim and recommended its inclusion in the records of the case. In its report, NBI stated that the victim has gunshot wound at the back of his thigh.
Ang chemistry division naman ng NBI ay tumugma po sa findings ng PAU na meron pong tama sa likod. Dahil yung tama po sa likod na yan ay nangangahulugan, pag binareparil ka sa likod, yan po yung murder.
The two HPG cops are facing torture and murder for allegedly hurting and killing the victim and robbery for his lost money. Preliminary investigation of the cases will resume on Tuesday. Roderick Mendoza, UNTV News and Rescue, Department of Justice.
Next in Y News. Final joint statement has been formally signed today in Oslo, Norway.
A senior citizen group seeks to hold a dialogue with President Rodrigo Duterte on VAT exemption. And Typhoon Dindo will exit the Philippine area of responsibility this weekend, but the country will still experience monsoon rains.
Y News will be right back. The Philippine government and the National Democratic Front of the Philippines, or NDFP, have concluded today their first round of talks by signing a joint statement for the contents of a comprehensive agreement. The negotiating panels then entertained questions from the press. NDFP Chief Negotiator Luis Halandoni emphasizes that the main purpose of the talks is to bring justice and peace in the entire country. This will only be possible with the cooperation of all the stakeholders on the ground. The negotiating panels request the support and contributions of every organization and the Filipino people for the realization of fundamental reforms and to address the roots of armed conflict in the country.
The people's participation and support is essential for the success of this effort.
Meanwhile, the Philippine Coast Guard, or PCG, will double the number of the members of its Special Operations Group. Yoshiko Sata will tell us why.
The Philippine Coast Guard aims to double the number of members of its Special Operations Group, or SOG, which is the frontliner in counterterrorism operations, search and rescue, law enforcement operations, and other challenges that the agency might face. This includes patrol operations in the West Philippine Sea to guard the territory and assist Filipino fishermen who are harassed by Chinese coast guards. At present, SOG has 500 members. Over 50 PCG personnel are now being trained to be part of the group. They will be trained for 6 months to acquire various special skills.
Sa West Philippine Sea, kasama sila dun sa mga small boat operations. So yun yung ating mga pangailangan na kailangan nilang tugunan. Specialized, so parang Navy SEAL ang katapat niyan eh.
Aside from males, the Philippine Coast Guard will also recruit female members for the Special Operations Group. Yoshiko Sata, UNTV News and Rescue, Philippines.
Meanwhile, the Ombudsman is investigating three incumbent and former lawmakers, officials of the Departments of Agrarian Reform and of Budget and Management, over a 220 million peso scam using DAR funds. Facing preliminary investigations over DAR scam are Senator Gringo Onason, former Senator Jingoy Ejercito Estrada, former Bulacan Congressman Arturo Robles, former DAR Secretary Virgilio De Los Reyes, and five DAR and DBM officials. The Ombudsman says 220 million pesos was allotted for livelihood trainings and projects of 27 municipalities in 2010 and 2011, but none were implemented. 13 non-government organizations were tasked to implement livelihood trainings and programs. 5 to 10 million pesos was allotted to each municipality. The Ombudsman says that documents show that there was deliberate or extensive use of falsified documents and forged signatures to justify use of the said large sum of money. In other news, the senior citizen group wants to hold a dialogue with President Rodrigo Duterte regarding their VAT exemption. Grace Cassin will tell us why.
Before the implementation of VAT exemption limitation for senior citizen, they want to talk first to President Rodrigo Duterte. They believe that the president will understand them as he himself is also a senior citizen.
Sana po, ipatawag man lang kami, ipaliwanag namin yung side namin.
This is after the Department of Finance announced that they will remove the VAT exemption for senior citizens eating in a luxury restaurant. DOF Secretary Carlos Dominguez III earlier explained that the VAT exemption for a senior citizen in food, education, and medicine stays. According to the secretary, they will bring back to the senior citizen through subsidy all the savings that they will be getting in this proposal.
Our dinner is, say, 800 or 1,000 pesos, right? I get a subsidy of 120, diba? And yet, the fellow who needs that 120, you know, the indigent senior citizen, does not get it because he does not have the 1,000 pesos to spend, diba? So in our view, that man should get more subsidy than me because I can afford it, okay? He cannot.
However, according to Francisco Datol Jr. of Senior Citizens Party List, they were sad after hearing this news. Datol explained that they should not prohibit senior citizens in eating in luxury restaurants.
Sa loob ng isang taon na yun, aalisin pa nila yung 20% doon. Mukha namang pinag-ipunan yung pensyon na pinaghirapan nila. Minsan lang kumain sa malalaking restaurant, aalisan pa nila yung kaligayahan ng senior citizen.
They appeal to the government to reconsider their plan for more than 10 million senior citizens around the country.
Bawa naman po kayo sa matatanda. Huwag na po ipagkait. Sandali na lang po itatagal nito.
Grace Cassin, UNTV News and Rescue, Quezon City.
The Department of Education believes that the inclusion of media and information literacy in the K-12 basic education curriculum would serve as a guide for the youth in exploring the cyber world. Aiko Miguel will tell us why.
The internet now contains almost all the information in the world, including the non-essential ones. Some studies show that the cyber world can sometimes be very dangerous. Just recently, a photo of a guy inside the MRT went viral on social media. The girl who was at the same train took the photo. In her caption, she says the guy was rude for not giving her his seat. The man didn't have an idea that his picture is now all over the internet. Netizens who saw the captioned picture got angry not on the guy, but on the girl who posted the image. What happened next is a series of bullying targeting her. Studies say cyberbullying can be avoided if the public has enough knowledge about the limitations in using the social media. One way of the Department of Education to give a proper guidance and information to the youth using the internet is the inclusion of the media and information literacy in the K-12 basic education curriculum.
It's offered between grades 11 and 12 ito. Okay, and another one sa yung strand natin sa senior high school, ino-offer din natin yung trends, network, and critical thinking in the 21st century. At isa sa critical content or essential content nun ay yung social networking or social media and ethics, netiquette, cyberbullying.
The Department of Education also launched in its online learning portal a cyber-safe manual last March. It includes the situation and questions on the proper way of using social media accounts.
Online manuals ito for grade 5 and 6 and junior high school. These are lesson plans, modules, learning modules na ang tawag natin ay cyber-safe learning manuals. Lesson plan talaga siya. I mean, this is a lesson plan na pwedeng gamitin ni teacher, strategies, ideas nandun na.
DepEd also created Children Protection Committee in schools whose members are principal, guidance counselor, teachers, and barangay officials to protect the rights of the students. Currently, Republic Act 10627 or the Anti-Bullying Act is already being implemented in the Philippines to penalize violators. House Bill 5718 or the Anti-Cyberbullying Act of 2015 that will emphasize the scope of cyberbullying as a crime is still pending at the House of Representatives. One way to prevent the youth to be bullied or be involved in cyberbullying is through the guidance of their parents in using social media accounts. It is important that their parents should spend time to safeguard their children, especially at home. Aiko Miguel, UNTV News and Rescue, Department of Education.
As some countries in the Americas experience tornadoes and heavy rainfall, people in Europe, particularly in Germany, could be seen going outside in droves. Ray Pelayo will tell us why.
In America, several tornadoes hit parts of central Indiana this week, destroying several houses and a Starbucks cafe. The ravage has also left power lines cut off, affecting thousands of Indianapolis area residents. Tornado warnings were issued in 27 countries. There were no reported deaths or major injuries. A large tornado struck near the state's capital, Indianapolis, as severe thunderstorms rolled through the region. The epicenter of the storm's damage was at Comoco City, north of Indianapolis, of which the large tornado left numerous houses destroyed and a Starbucks cafe flattened. In Mexico, Mexico is expecting an increased and continued rainfall in the coming months. This has prompted the government to issue warning to residents to remain vigilant and heed the advice of the government and civil protection authorities. Tropical Storm Earl hit Mexico in the first week of August, leaving 50 people dead, thousands of houses destroyed, and millions of dollars worth of damages. The Civil Protection of Mexico says about 16 storms are expected to form in the Pacific and Atlantic Ocean this season, which would bring heavier rainfall because of the soaring temperature. The United Nations estimates that the combined effect of El Niño and La Niña will affect about 100 million people until the end of the year. In Germany, while other countries are experiencing the brunt of storms, Europeans are still enjoying the summer heat. This is particularly true in Germany. People could be seen going out in droves to enjoy the highly anticipated heat wave before the season's end. Temperatures reached 80 degrees Fahrenheit on Wednesday in Germany, and forecasters expect the heat to continue for the last few days. Ray Pelayo, UNTV News and Rescue.
Typhoon Dindo will possibly exit the Philippine area of responsibility tomorrow. Rosalie Cos is at the UNTV Weather Forecasting Center to tell us why. Rosalie, are we going to have a rainy weekend?
Good evening, Diego. The Philippine Atmospheric, Geophysical and Astronomical Services Administration or PAGASA says there will be a rainy weekend because Typhoon Dindo still enhances the southwest monsoon, which will bring rains over the western section of Luzon.
Okay, Rosalie, please give us the latest weather update.
Thank you, Diego. As of 4 p.m. today, the eye of Typhoon Dindo was estimated based on all available data at 1,025 kilometers east-northeast of Itbayat, Batanes. Although it is to exit the Philippine area of responsibility tomorrow late afternoon or early evening, it still enhances the southwest monsoon. Typhoon Dindo has maximum sustained winds of 160 kilometers per hour near the center and has gustiness of up to 195 kilometers per hour. Cloudy skies with light to moderate rains will be experienced over Metro Manila, Pangasinan, Zambales, Bataan, Tarlac, Pampanga, Cavite, Batangas, and Palawan. Over the rest of the country, isolated rain showers and thunderstorms will prevail. Tomorrow's forecast says temperature in Metro Manila may reach up to 31 degrees Celsius, Tuguegarao City at 33 degrees Celsius, Baguio City at 16 to 21 degrees Celsius, and Puerto Princesa at 32 degrees Celsius. In Visayas, tomorrow's forecast in Metro Cebu may reach up to 34 degrees Celsius, Iloilo and Bacolod City at 33 degrees Celsius, Tacloban City at 33 degrees Celsius. In Mindanao, temperature in Metro Davao may reach up to 34 degrees Celsius, Cagayan de Oro City at 34 degrees Celsius, Valencia City at 29 degrees Celsius, and Zamboanga City at 31 degrees Celsius. The State Weather Bureau always reminds everyone to take precautionary measures against possible flash floods and strong winds brought about by isolated rain showers and thunderstorms. Keep safe, everyone, but lean on and trust in the Almighty. That is our latest weather update. Happy weekends. Back to studio.
Thank you, Rosalie Cos, reporting from the UNTV Weather Forecasting Center. Coming up, the Bolivian government confirms that Bolivian Deputy Interior Minister Rodolfo Illanes has died.
The home and studio of late U.S. rocker Prince are set to be opened to the public.
AFP Cavaliers on full battle gear for the UNTV Cup Season 5.
More from Y News after this break. President Rodrigo Duterte changes his stand and now favors the postponement of the Barangay and Sanggunian Kabataan elections slated on October 31, 2016. In his speech during the 10th anniversary rites of the Eastern Mindanao Commands in Panakan, Davao City, President Duterte expresses his fear that drug money might seep into the electoral process.
Do you know the reason why I also agreed with Congress, some congressmen, to postpone the barangay elections? Do you know why? Because I am afraid that the drug money will seep into the electoral process. Those that are funded by drug money will win, at kailangan mo nang mag-martial law para to eliminate all, which I will never do in the first place.
President Duterte also sees that the billions of pesos earmarked for the elections can be used to fund the government's anti-drug campaign, particularly for the construction and improvement of rehabilitation centers. Hundreds of inmates in Binyan City Jail benefited from the free medical mission rendered by UNTV Servisyong Kasangbahay and Members Church of God International. Sherwin Kulubong tells us why.
Over 400 inmates in Binyan City Jail in Laguna have benefited from the free medical mission rendered by UNTV Servisyong Kasangbahay and Members Church of God International.
Sa BGMP kasi kailangan natin mga mapagtuunan din mga health ng ating mga inmate para matingnan natin kung meron silang mga sakit at ang mga nararamdaman para matulungan din po natin sila.
Binyan City Jail has the most crowded detention cells in Laguna. 570 inmates who are mostly involved in drug-related cases occupy each of its four jail cells. The limited and crowded space makes the prisoners prone to diseases. Unfortunately, most of them are deprived of medications because their relatives no longer visit them. Because of this, the inmates express their gratitude for the free medical services provided by UNTB and MCGI with the help of the doctors from the Philippine Medical Association Laguna Chapter.
Nagpapasalamat po sa mga tumitingin dito. Sigurado na supportan po kami ng gamit po.
Nagpapasalamat po ako gawa ng ito para pinandahan kami rito at para malunasan yung aming mga nararamdaman.
The management of Binyan City Jail also extended their gratitude to the group.
Maganda po, very overwhelmed po kami sa pagdating po ng grupo ninyo. At kompleto po yung mga gamit, marami pong doktor na nandyan at para mas mapabilis po yung pag-check up sa ating inmate. And isa pong malaking bagay na pasalamat talaga namin na matingnan po yung aming mga kliyente dito sa Binyan City Jail po. Kay Brother Eli sa Kuya Daniel, maraming salamat po sa medical pag-unlock nyo sa aming healing na medical mission sa Binyan City Jail po.
Among the free services rendered were medical and dental consultation, chest x-ray, electrocardiogram or ECG, and optical consultation. Free reading glasses and medicines were also given as prescribed. Sherwin Kulubong for Servisyong Kasangbahay.
The Bolivian government confirms that Bolivian Deputy Interior Minister Rodolfo Illanes has died. Meanwhile, Lot Group Vice Chairman was found dead southeast of Seoul, South Korea. Ann Nunez will tell us why.
In South Korea, a senior executive of South Korea's Lot Group has died in a suspected suicide. The country's fifth-largest family-run conglomerate announced this earlier today amid a sweeping criminal probe into the business. Lot Group, in a text message to reporters, said it confirmed the death of Vice Chairman Lee In-won through police and other sources. It did not elaborate further or give the cause of death. Prosecutors raided Lot offices in June, looking into a possible slush fund as well as breach of trust involving transactions among the group's company, sources said. Lee, who was 69 and the number two ranking executive in the group, had been scheduled to appear before prosecutors on Friday morning for questioning. In Costa Rica, Cuban migrants are growing restless after being denied passage north towards the United States amid a worsening situation compounded by the arrival of Haitians. The flow of migrants from Cuba has surged since late last year as the process of a detent between Washington and Havana stirs fears that preferential U.S. asylum rights for Cubans may soon end. The number of irregular migrants keeps on rising. Recently, Haitians have been reportedly been arriving in Costa Rica, also seeking a better life in the United States. With more than 60% of Haitians living in extreme poverty, many are simply seeking the chance of a better life. Costa Rica has set up migrant centers to provide basic assistance to migrants, but with no imminent solution to the situation, many fear it could blow out to a humanitarian emergency. In Bolivia, the Bolivian government confirmed on Thursday that Bolivian Deputy Interior Minister Rodolfo Illanes was beaten to death by striking mine workers after being kidnapped. The government says the 56-year-old Illanes had been kidnapped and was at risk of being tortured after he went to talk to protesters earlier on Thursday in Panduro, around 160 kilometers from capital La Paz. Protests by miners in Bolivia demanding changes to laws turned violent this week after a highway was blockaded. Two workers were killed on Wednesday after being shot by police, and the government said 17 police officers had been wounded. The National Federation of Mining Cooperatives of Bolivia began what they said would be an indefinite protest after negotiations over mining legislation failed. Protesters have been demanding for mining concessions, the right to work for private companies, and greater union representation. Ann Nunez, UNTV News and Rescue, Philippines.
The AFP Cavaliers team manager believes that Season 5 of the UNTV Cup will be very exciting and very challenging with the entry of new players in other teams. Bernard Dadis will tell us why.
UNTV Cup defending champion AFP Cavaliers are on their full battle gear as the new season of the only league for public servants fast approaches. Ahead of the opening ceremonies, AFP Cavaliers team manager Brigadier General Genero Del Rosario says his team is ready for battle no matter which team they face up with. He believes that the new faces in other teams will bring a great impact in the tournament. Some of them are former players in professional basketball.
The way I see it, prepared ang team to para sa UNTV na basketball. That's the idea nga na palakasin yung mga ibang team na nagre-lag behind during the last season. And I believe it will be good for the this league kasi yung mga teams is magiging very competitive ngayon ang mga competitions, which will be very exciting para sa pag-tournament. Talagang magaganda ang mangyayari.
Winston Serio open. Yes!
It can be recalled that the Cavaliers beat the PNP responders twice, which happened in Season 2 and Season 4.
All over him. Nice curl. Nice block. Back to the side. Bautista.
A key to the Cavaliers' victory last season was former professional basketball player Boyet Bautista, who was also hailed as the finals' most valuable player. Team AFP invites all the supporters of the charity game to watch out for a more empowered Cavaliers roster in the Season 5 opening ceremonies.
We would like to thank the UNTV for this concept ng tournament, which is for the benefit ng ating mga dependents ng
Bernard Dadis reporting for UNTV Cup Season 5.
The only basketball league for public servants, the UNTV Cup, is now in its fifth season. 13 fueled teams will compete for the season title. These are the Malacanang Patriots, Senate Defenders, Judiciary Madges, HOR Solons, PNP Responders, AFP Cavaliers, GSIS Furies, DOJ Justice Boosters, NHA Builders, MMDA Black Wolves, BFP Firefighters, Ombudsman Graph Busters, and the BOC Transformers. The opening ceremony is on Monday, August 29 at the SM Mall of Asia Arena. Apple issues a security patch to fix glitches in the security protocol of iPhones and iPads. Aaron Romero will tell us why.
Apple Incorporated issued a patch on Thursday to fix a dangerous security hole in iPhones and iPads after researchers discovered that a prominent United Arab Emirates dissident's phone had been targeted with a previously unknown method of hacking. The attack on the dissident, Ahmed Mansour, used a text message that invited him to click on a web link. Instead of clicking, he forwarded the message to researchers at the University of Toronto's Citizen Lab. Experts there worked with security company Lookout and determined that the link would have installed a program taking advantage of a flaw that Apple and others were not aware of. The researchers disclosed their findings on Thursday. The researchers said that they had alerted Apple, which developed a fix and distributed it as an automatic update to iPhone 6 owners. Apple spokesman Fred Saines confirmed that the company had issued the patch after being contacted by researchers about the issue. Aaron Romero, UNTV News and Rescue, New York.
A scuba diving experience on Barracuda Lake in Palawan is considered the craziest dive in the country. Brian Evangelista will tell us why.
Kasama ang pamilya, barkada,
lahat buong grupo para mag-enjoy ng todo.
Located in the north shore of the marvelous Coron, Palawan is a breathtaking dive site considered to be one of the most fascinating in the country. Using the UNTV drone, we can see this wonder of creation, which proves to be a must-see. Barracuda Lake offers a treat of the craziest dive as well as an action-packed adventure upon entrance through limestone formations and climbing the 40 wooden stairs into the lake. Be sure to be well-equipped in scuba diving full gear when diving and expect different layers of temperature which varies from 27 degrees Celsius to 38 degrees Celsius under a 14-meter depth.
The very funny thing is some places where the water is colder, some places where the water is hotter.
And the water is beautifully clean.
It's a very special experience.
Unique. You don't get this anywhere else.
And it won't be called the Barracuda Lake without the king of the lake, the Barracuda.
Barracuda. We saw a Barracuda about a meter and something long. That is very surprising because this is supposed to be an enclosed area. So maybe it has communication with the sea even if...
Numerous species of underwater creatures await divers and visitors too. Call it unique, bizarre, outrageous, or simply amazing. But undoubtedly, Barracuda Island is something to thank God for. Brian Evangelista, UNTV News and Rescue, Palawan.
Paisley Park, the suburban Minneapolis State and studio of late rock musician Prince, will be open for public tours starting October 6. The administrator of the singer's estate says an application for development review and a business plan has been submitted to Chan Hazen officials. Prince, 57, collapsed and died at the 65,000 square foot estate after an accidental overdose of the powerful opioid fentanyl. Prince hits included Purple Rain and One Dove's Cry.
Have a safe and happy weekend.
Yes, you too.
Those are the reasons behind the news, August 26, 2016. I'm Angelo Castro III.
Reasons we deliver to you as they unfold. I'm Gerry Alcantara.
And I'm Darlene Basingan. Because we need to know,
we will always ask why. Thank you for watching
Why News.